Hi friends, welcome back. Welcome to the daily current affairs quiz discussion where we will discuss top 5 current affairs questions from today's newspaper for the UPSC prelims examination 2025. So guys, let us see the first topic. So first topic, I have framed a question on PM Kisan. Guys, every year you have questions coming in the prelims examination on schemes. So guys, over 1 lakh farmers voluntarily have given up the PM Kisan benefits. In this context, I have framed a question. Consider the following regarding Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi, which is also called PM Kisan. It is centrally sponsored scheme. So you can see here, first statement is it is a centrally sponsored scheme. Second statement, it aims at providing financial assistance to all cultivable landholding farmer families across the country. And the third statement, under the scheme, an amount of 6,000 rupees is transferred annually in 2 installment of rupees 3,000 directly into Aadhaar seeded bank accounts of the farmers. So guys, one thing I need to tell you is that when you prepare any scheme, first thing what you need to prepare is that what is the nature of scheme? Is it a centrally sponsored scheme or is it a central sector scheme? So guys, this is not a centrally sponsored scheme. This is a central sector scheme. Central sector scheme. What is a central sector scheme and how is it different from centrally sponsored scheme? Guys, central sector scheme, the entire contribution comes from the center. So central ministry will fund the entire contribution for the fund. Whereas in centrally sponsored scheme, what happens is that although the planning of the scheme is done by the center, but the funding is shared by both the center and the state. Okay, so generally you can see this is an incorrect statement. Second, it says that it aims at providing financial assistance to all cultivable landholding farming families. Okay, so this is an incorrect statement because only eligible farming families are allowed. Okay, so there are some limitations. There are some limitations here. Okay, so they are not like all farmers are not allowed. So this is again an incorrect statement. And third is, under the scheme, an amount of 6,000 is transferred in 2 equal installment of 3,000. It is incorrect. There are 3 equal installment of 2,000 each. So guys, you see generally facts-based statements are also incorrect. Generally fact-based statements are incorrect. So you can see here, guys, how many of the above statements are correct? So answer will be none of the above statements are correct. Second question, guys. Second question I have framed on election petitions. Guys, you know that elections are going on in some of the state assemblies and the general election is going on. So there is a provision of election petition. Okay. So let us see the question regarding election petition. Statement 1 says an election petition is a procedure for inquiring into the validity of an election result of a parliamentary or local government elections. This is a correct statement. Statement 2 says, as per the constitution, only the Supreme Court has the original jurisdiction on deciding election petitions. So guys, as per the RPA Act, the high courts have the original jurisdiction over the election petitions. So statement 2 is incorrect. So the answer will be option C. Option C. Guys, so let us see. What are election petitions? Guys, election petitions basically are filed when there is a question on the election outcome. So guys, you can see here an election petition calling in question any election can be presented on one or more of the following grounds. So what are the grounds of election petition? That on the date of election, a returned candidate, a candidate who has not been declared elected, was not qualified. Second, that some corrupt practices was committed by the returned candidate on or his election agent. Third, that any nomination was improperly rejected and the result was materially affected. If any of this is true, a high court where the petition is submitted declares the election of the returned candidate to be void. A election petition can be submitted by a candidate or elector within 45 days of declaration of result. So this is very, very important that whenever election results are declared, within 45 days, you can challenge the election. Within 45 days, you can challenge the election and High Court can make the election result void under these circumstances. Under these circumstances, so this 45 days, okay, can be used to frame a question on election petition. Remember, election petition is heard at High Court level, and it has to be filed by the candidate or the elector within 45 days of the declaration of the result. This is very, very important. Let us see the next question, guys. Next question is on hung parliament. Guys, you know that the BJP has not got the majority this time. So guys, in this context, I framed a question. You can see the question: a hung parliament is an event of any party not securing majority by itself or in combination with pre-poll alliance. Statement 2 says constitution has clear provisions regarding hung parliament. So guys, first statement is correct. Second statement is not correct, because constitution does not have clear provisions regarding hung parliament. Various presidents in the past, they have developed some conventions regarding hung parliament. I'll just explain you what are these. Okay, so first statement will be correct. Second statement is incorrect. So the answer is one only. So guys, generally whenever in UPSC, they will say the constitution has clear provisions regarding something, generally you can eliminate that option using option elimination, because there is a trick that generally statement saying that the constitution mandates, the constitution clarifies, those statements are incorrect. Now let me come to convention. So what happens is that whenever there is a hung parliament, what happens, the president can basically ask the single largest party to come and prove its majority, or the party which has pre-poll alliance with other parties, and if it has majority, then that party will be asked to prove the majority on the floor of the house. Okay, so this is very, very important, guys. Next question is on exit polls. Okay, you can see a few days back exit poll was out and it gave huge majority to the BJP party. So in that context, I have framed a question. Consider the following: exit polls are conducted well before the election to gauge public voting intentions. Statement 2, opinion polls are conducted immediately after the voters leaving the polling stations on the election day. So guys, this both statements are incorrect. Why? Because it is the exit poll which is conducted after the voters come out of the polling station on the election day. So this is exit poll and this is the opinion poll. This is called rule of interchange, guys. Rule of interchange. Generally, it is used by UPSC. So guys, RPA Act basically regulates exit polls. Okay, this is very, very important. RPA Act, Representation of People Act, it regulates the exit poll. Okay, the result of the exit poll can only be declared 30 minutes after the last day of voting. Okay, this is very, very important. So here, none of the statements are correct. Next question, guys. You can see G Entertainment plans to raise fund via shares and QIPs. Okay, qualified institutional placement. So I have framed a question on qualified institutional placement, guys. These days, you know, capital market is doing very good, so most of the companies are raising capital because the markets are doing good. So this qualified institutional placement is one of the ways of raising capital, guys. You can see this question: qualified institutional placement route is turning out to be the most preferred route for the companies looking to raise capital. It is a capital raising tool allowing listed companies to raise funds from qualified institutional buyers by issuing fresh equity share, fully or partly convertible debentures, or any securities other than warrants convertible to equity shares. How many of the following are qualified institutional buyers? Public financial institution, yes. Scheduled commercial banks, yes. Mutual fund, yes. Retail investors, no. Retail investors are not qualified as qualified institutional buyers. Even the high net worth individuals are also not qualified as qualified institutional buyers. So the answer is only 3. Answer is option B. So guys, like, see, you see how we have solved questions on economy, then polity, because most of the questions today I have framed is on polity because of the elections. I hope you like this discussion, guys. Please do support our initiative if you like this initiative. I will be continuing this initiative throughout the year for the prelims 2025. Let me tell you, I promise you, many questions from this initiative is going to come in your UPSC prelims examination 2025. Thank you, guys. Bye-bye. Take care.